Well, thank you for that generous introduction. And I want to thank the CIC organizers for inviting me to this exciting event. And also want to thank Dr. Imai and Canon for making this possible. And before I talk about computational photography, let's talk about digital photography. And maybe it's faster, maybe it's cheaper, but arguably, digital photography has barely changed our experience when it comes to capturing and sharing visual information. And in terms of digital photography, let's go all the way back to one of the first digital cameras in the early 90s. A very commendable effort, collaboration between Kodak and Nikon to add a digital sensor to a Nikon camera. But do you see something unusual in this picture if you crack open the back of this Nikon camera? The film cartridge is still there. The space, empty space for the film cartridge. I guess that's how the world works. It's a digital camera with just a leftover space for film cartridge. And stayed for 4 years in multiple versions of these cameras. And so my collaborator Jack Tumblin likes to compare digital photography with a caged lion who has been caged for years and uncaged in a jungle. And instead of rushing out to explore the jungle, the lion just stays in one place. And if you think about billions of cameras that are out there being sold every year, mostly because of cell phones, you know, they're also locked in this cage. And they're all trying to mimic the human eye. But if you just look at the space of successful biological vision, there's a lot of diversity. You know, there's based on shadows, based on refraction, based on reflection. I mean, lobsters and scallops, they use segmented mirrors or sequence of mirrors, not lenses. Think about that when you're enjoying your seafood tomorrow night. And if you think about, you know, CPUs, they don't mimic a human brain, and robots don't mimic human locomotion, but somehow cameras continue to mimic the human eye. So what we do in our group is really challenge that notion that to capture and share visual experience, we should stick to this one design that's based on refraction and single chamber. And if you think about photography in general, and if you ask, what's the wish list? You know, what do you want to get? You'll often hear things like, I want superhuman vision and amazing resolution. I want automatically be able to trigger a photo based on smile, or have amazing battery life. Be automatically able to tag pictures and find out what's a good picture. And when I talk to photography enthusiasts, I think the number one request I get is, let's solve the missing father problem in family albums. You know, let's put the photographer back into the picture. And if you talk to companies, of course, number one is cost, right? Resolution, HDR, features that can be achieved without mechanical motion, automatic tracking, face recognition, and so on. And I'm not mentioning things that are already there. This is the wish list, so things that are not out there yet. GPS and face recognition and so on, I'm not putting on this list here. But let's try to dream really big and try to think well beyond this list and think about next 10 to 15 years. Okay? How about a camera that allows you to look around the corner beyond line of sight? So I should be able to take a picture right now and be actually able to see the back of all your shirts and even what's outside that door. Seems like we're breaking laws of physics. Or cameras that directly create, instead of photorealism, they create emotive renderings. And to achieve that, we need to use computational photography. And so this talk is really going to be about a wish list for computational photography. And again, by definition, these are not the things that are possible today. And I don't even know for some of these things how we will get there. But we're just going to dream here. And I'm going to give you a flavor of what's going on in my lab and elsewhere. And the strategy in computational photography is to really be sophisticated, not just in terms of the bits, in terms of the software, but also be smart about how we process the photons. So it's about the co-design of optical processing and digital processing, and computational photography kind of really lies at the intersection of these fields. So I'm going to go through a few wishes, you know, five of them, and see how you respond to them. The first one is I want ultimate post-capture control. Everything I should be able to fix after the photo is taken. And I want to simplify the decisions at the time of capture. A very good example of that is a light-field camera, the Panoptic camera out of Stanford, Professor Mark Lavoie's group. And the idea there is to use macro lenses on top of a sensor so that after the photo is taken, you can digitally refocus. Right? It's an amazing control. And in this case, you start with a 16 megapixel picture, and then you can refocus images that are unfortunately down to only about 300 pixels. But still, it's very powerful. So what we did in our group is, instead of using macro lenses, we just use a mask in very close to the sensor, not on top of the sensor, but displaced slightly from the sensor. And you can take a digital medium format camera and with a digital bag and simply insert this film, a very high quality film, which cost you about a couple of dollars, to convert an ordinary digital camera into a light field camera that captures not just the intensities, but also captures the angular variation of light that's incident on each pixel. And that's about dealing with focus blur post-capture. What about the wish of being able to capture low light photos and dealing with motion blur? Right? And if you take a photo of this kind and you try to de-blur it in software, so if you take an ordinary camera and try to de-blur in software, you will get ringing and banding artifacts because the blur creates nulls in the frequency domain. So maybe there's something we can do at the time of capture. So we came up with the solution of using a flutter shutter camera, which means within one exposure of a camera, the shutter opens, but we're going to open and close it in a carefully chosen binary sequence. So at the end, we still get one photo, but all the high spatial frequencies are preserved. Okay? And of course, if you do that mechanically, you will void the warranty of the camera right away. So we instead used an LCD, a ferroelectric LCD indeed, to make it opaque and transparent. And opaque is binary 0 and transparent is binary 1. And we can encode the information in a single photo by preserving all the spatial frequencies and getting rid of the nulls that are introduced because of the convolution of motion blur. And from that, we can start doing some interesting things. So this is a photo taken in Cambridge on the street. And if you zoom in the blur photo, you can barely make out the car make here. Any guesses which car company it is? Audi? And what about the license plate? Any numbers you want to pick? Five. I got a five. I got a four. Any letters? I thought you all had deconvolution filters built into your eyes. If you deblur that with this flutter shutter camera, you can actually recover all the high spatial frequencies. The car company is Volkswagen. I guess Audi is Volkswagen, just going really fast. And you can also pick out the license plate. And this is possible only because you have a slight modification to the camera. And of course, instead of using the ferroelectric LCD, this can be implemented directly on the sensor if you have a CMOS sensor. So that was about focus and motion blur. What about lighting? Okay, so cameras have shrunk and become extremely compact, and lots of decisions are automatically taken, such as exposure and so on, by the camera. But if you think about lighting, it's still very challenging. And I would argue that the only difference, or the main difference between a professional photographer and consumer photographer today, is the lighting, right? And you have to carry a lot of bulk. And it would be nice if we can shrink all that complex lighting gear into the flash. So my wish is that a camera has a compact flash, but it still allows me to create effects as if I have studio lighting. So that's wish number one. How can we have ultimate post-capture control for blur and for lighting? Okay. Wish number two, freedom from form. You know, we went through this whole phase of carrying really bulky and heavy cameras, and now we're into micro four thirds, and you know, we're trying to make it simpler and simpler and more compact and still be able to capture light and process it. So what can we do then? Think about color, right? The only way to manipulate color now at the time of capture is by carrying a set of filters, right? Somehow it's still not a dial on your camera to be able to manipulate color. Okay, and then if you have a scene pixel, scene point that has color outside your gamut, you're just going to take a projection. And you can try to be smart about it, try to get a wider color gamut, but then you have a trade-off between the efficiency and color rendition. And this seems to be a constant struggle. Imagine if your camera somehow did all of this depending on the scene, like it decides the exposure time depending on the scene. Right, so when you have when you're outdoors and looking at a grassy area, you have a color gamut that captures the greens. And if you have something that's reddish, it automatically shifts its gamut. Right, so this is not multispectral imaging, but it's just imaging where the gamut is moved around. Right, so this is a very challenging problem, and Ankit Mohan, who's here right back there, who used to work with me, but now has been snatched away to work at Canon. Came up with a brilliant idea called Agile Spectrum Imaging. It's programmable spectrum imaging, and his idea was to introduce a single diffraction grating to disperse the light, and using a very simple idea of using an additional lens, he invented a concept called a rainbow plane. And in that rainbow plane, it turns out you can do complete digital manipulation of your gamut. Okay, and just to make sure it's clear, without any manipulation, you will get an ordinary image, consumer will see an ordinary image. But in that rainbow plane, you can introduce DMDs or LCDs or any SLM to manipulate your gamut. And by doing that, here's an example of something that's very saturated in green. So your gamut forces the dynamic range, it affects your dynamic range, and even your blue and blue and red channels are also affected. But if I just can clip away that green color, again using this rainbow plane effect, then it turns out you can recover rest of the information. It's just a demonstration that you can manipulate the gamut digitally. Right? And so imagine instead of using a bag of filters that changes your scene and having fixed primaries on your sensor, now you have complete digital control. Another problem is with form is that to create a very shallow depth of field, people end up buying a lot of glass, right? Because you want to create this very unnatural effect of extremely shallow slabs of focus. And the problem, of course, is that this glass is very heavy and bulky and so on. And what I would like to do is just use a very tiny aperture and somehow able to figure out, somehow be able to synthesize a picture as if it had a sufficiently large aperture for shallow depth of field. So Ankit Mohan again came up with this very interesting idea of exploiting the stabilization of your sensor. And as you know, to achieve optical stabilization, you have a relative movement between the sensor and the lens. Well, what if you intentionally exploit that? Intentionally create a relative displacement between the lens and the sensor, then you can move the lens and sensor at relative speeds. And depending on the speed at which, depending on the relative speed, you can effectively end up creating a time lens. And the time lens will have all the parameters of a traditional space lens or a glass lens, so that such as focal length and slabs of focus, your hyperfocal distance, and so on. So, I encourage you to look at his thesis to see how he has exploited that. And if you really think about it, although you have a very tiny aperture, there's plenty of space around it that can be used using, you know, just piezoelectric motors to shake it while you're holding the camera to simulate a large blur. So we think this is, you know, to again simplify the dimensions of your camera, exploiting time is going to be a very powerful mechanism. So here are some results. So this is a picture taken with a very small aperture, all in focus. But by using this time lens, relative motion between the lens and the sensor, you can focus all the way in the front. But by using a slightly different motion, you can focus in the middle or focus in the back. Right? All using the same sensor and lens. And if you think about freedom from form, we also have a similar situation in medical imaging, where we have these really large devices that are being used to record imagery. And the principles are same: optics and image processing and signal analysis and so on. And medical imaging is today where photography was, 50 years ago. You know, and photography in 1950s, you had to go to a special place. There'll be a special guy. He'll go under the hood. And he says, freeze for a few seconds. You freeze, don't breathe. You know, guy takes a picture, he says, go home, and you'll get your results, your photo, in a couple of days. And that's where we are today. If you want to go get your CAT scan, or if you want to get your anything scanned, right? There's a special place, special guy, wait for a couple of days. And today, we have come to a stage in photography where if you spill, coffee on your shirt, I take a picture, right? So we have become really casual in the way we think about photography. We don't wait for that Kodak moment. We go for that night. We go to, instead of Kodak moment, we have the Nokia moment or the iPhone moment now, right? So in medical imaging, can we do the same thing? And so we have been exploring that in our group and creating unusual medical solutions. So here's the idea where instead of using very complicated devices, imagine if you can, with a small optical piece, look at your cell phone, interactively align some patterns with the keyboard of the phone and hit calculate, and it gives you the data for prescription of your eyeglasses. So this is a project called Netra, which means eye in Sanskrit, and very conveniently it also stands for a near eye tool for refractive assessment. So that was about simplifying the form. Wish number three, I would like the camera to have a complete awareness, completely understand the scene that is photographing, using, again, processing of photons and processing of the bits. And we have some really amazing things happening right now, using something like Photosynth or phototourism that was invented by Steve Seitz and Noah Snavely and Rick Zaliski at Washington and Microsoft. You can take a photo now and immediately place it in a 3D world by exploiting the fact that the community photo collections, such as Flickr, have hundreds of photos, maybe thousands of photos, of the tourist location you might be. So here you have Notre Dame, and the moment you take a photo, you could actually create a 3D representation or place it in 3D where you want. Or you can try to answer even more challenging questions, such as if I'm in Trevi Fountain and I'm a tourist, if I take a picture, I would just like automatically the pixels to be labeled as to what's interesting here, right? If I'm in Trevi Fountain, the fountain is really important, the buildings are not very important. But if I'm in Prague, then in the old town square, the fountain down there is actually not so important, but the top of the buildings are very important. And no signal processing, image processing can help you do that. But community photo collections will allow you to do that, because we can simply vote based on thousands of pictures available on Flickr which pixels are more interesting than others. And by interest here is simply how many photos are looking at that 3D point in the world. So this instant awareness, I think, is really amazing. But what about being able to see beyond a corner? So you have a camera that's outside and you want to see what's inside. It seems like they're breaking laws of physics. If you're breaking some laws, hope you won't report us. And what if you want to photograph something that's that's, you know, something very specific inside the room. The idea is to use bounces of light. So you use the flash, illuminate the door, a fraction of the light will bounce into the room, a tiny fraction of the light will bounce back to the door, and even tinier fraction will go back to the camera. And if you can just analyze this echoes of light, then it turns out we can actually look around corners. And the idea here is to use a time-resolved imaging, very similar to LiDAR, which uses time of flight, but it's kind of a LiDAR on steroids. And for that, we have to use some high-end equipment, which we call femtophotography. So our flashes are on for a few femtoseconds, 10 to the minus 15 seconds, and our sensor is not a million frames per second, not a billion frames per second, but a trillion frames per second. And at that speed of your sensor, it turns out you can start doing some amazing things, and you can start analyzing the path of every photon that's bouncing around in the room. And it turns out these trillion frames per second cameras are already used in chemistry. There was a Nobel Prize in 1999 for femtochemistry. So those cameras are around, but they cost quite a bit. They cost, you know, close to $500,000. But nevertheless, over time, in a few years, they might be available for something that's, say, under $100. And if you don't believe that, just think about the flatbed scanners that used to cost about $250,000 just about 30 years ago. And today we can buy them for under $100. So I think imaging of this kind will open up completely new opportunities, such as being able to look inside buildings for rescue and planning, robotics and navigation, being able to compute the navigation paths even before you take the bend. But the application we are really targeting in our group is endoscopy, so that endoscopes can reach endoscopes can go into very tight spaces and look at the maze of cavities without having to physically explore every cavity, and again be able to look around corners. So this is a major effort in our group, and you will hear about it in coming weeks. So I guess we can definitely help the bunny figure out if it's safe enough to go inside the room and if Elmer's there. But while we're trying to save the bunny, something else is happening in the world. The barcodes are taking over the world. They're everywhere, and they're really annoying, because barcodes are for machine-to-machine interaction between cameras and tagged information. But you know, we're not using barcodes with checkout counter laser scanners anymore. We're using our cameras, you know. And given that now we have, 3 billion cameras out there in people's pocket, we need to upgrade our world so that it's more compatible with those billions of cameras. We can't continue to use those old barcodes. So here's an idea. We created a new form of, these are standard data matrix codes and QR codes, and that's our barcode. So it looks as simple as this, and just this tiny dot here is our barcode, which we call barcode. And the reason for that is, with an ordinary eye or a camera in sharp focus, this is how it looks. But if you just throw the camera out of focus, the pattern is revealed. Okay? And what we're doing here is we're encoding the information not in space or wavelength or time, but we're encoding it in angle. And to reveal that, we're not using the zoom of the camera, but we're just using the defocus. So you can see the other patterns are still there, visible. And when we encode information in angle, if you take an image in sharp focus, so again, the radiance of the rays out of this barcode are varying. If you take an image in sharp focus, you just see this dot. But if you just throw the camera out of focus, then the point spread function, or circle of confusion, now becomes circle of information. And then we can do standard things like tagging objects so that you can just take your cell phone and recover the information, or maybe Google trucks can communicate with tiny dots that are on top of shops or restaurants and communicate with them without having to put these big barcodes on the outdoors. And another interesting part is that if you take the phone really close, camera phone really close to the vocoder, by the way, it's vocoder because it's based on the bokeh principle, the out of focus blur, Japanese word for blur. And it's a code that's based on the principle of bokeh. And the interesting part is if you take the camera really close to the vocoder, you can reveal tens of thousands of bytes of information. A typical barcode will only have about 100 bits of information. So a whole ringtone or a bus schedule or a restaurant menu or information about a product can all be embedded in a tiny micro dot. And that can be decoded by your cell phone camera, but not necessarily by, it doesn't really interfere with the aesthetics of your surroundings. So to understand the world, we want mechanisms that exploit community photo collections, you know, cameras that go at trillion frames per second and upgrade our world so that our cameras can again provide us a more meaningful visual experience. All right, let's go to wish number four. Despite, you know, we're talking about beautiful cameras, we're talking about cameras and devices that have modern form factor, but they're all useless unless we can actually share the experience that's captured by those cameras. So there are certain things that are going on. I think we are all very soon going to have cameras that are mounted on our bodies that are acting as assistants. So we have a life log. But of course, looking at the life log is very boring, so automatic summary of that life log is very critical. And once these cameras are everywhere, imagine all of you are wearing a camera, we want some way to maintain our privacy and authenticate in public. And today you are very comfortable, for example, using your credit card in public. You know, you give your credit card in a restaurant to this woman who you don't know, and she goes somewhere in the back of the restaurant in a dark alley, and she swipes it some more time, and you know, all kinds of strange things happen. And in the meantime, she knows it, the restaurant owner knows it, the bank knows it, the government knows it, and everybody knows your financial information, but somehow you don't feel so scared giving this card to this completely unknown person, right? And we don't have the same sense of security with cameras. Imagine there are millions of cameras, and I should be just able to walk down the street knowing that I have complete control over which camera can use my information in which way. Okay? And the same structure that we have in the financial world, maybe we can bring that in the visual semantic world. Again, that's a wish. We don't know the solutions for it, and we can discuss it later on. Okay, what about photo frames? Isn't it very disappointing that you go on a trip, you take this beautiful 10, 15, 20 megapixel camera, and you come home and you show it on this tiny, you know, half a megapixel, 1 megapixel photo frame. Or even if you have a desktop, it's maybe 2 megapixel. What happened to the time when, you know, 20 years ago, when you could take your film camera, scan it, and bring it home, make slides, and look at this extremely high resolution slides? Like, what happened to that? Don't we want to bring that experience back of a good 10-20 megapixel slide that really captures your experience? So I think we need to go back in time and see if we can create some great photo frames. So one project we're working on is called a slow display. You know, let's get rid of this fascination with 60 hertz, 120 hertz, 240 hertz update rates, and let's go back to a display that updates only once every 10 seconds. Just like a slide projector. But it has a resolution of 10, 20, 30, 40 megapixel. And in the meantime, it also runs on very low power. And the solution for that we came up with is an idea based on monostable materials, which can be written with light, and they stay on for several seconds, usually about 5 to 10 seconds. And then they disappear, they fade away. And if you use photochromic materials, then you can just use a near UV laser, and then right on this photochromic material, it changes color and stays on for a few seconds. But the challenge is that if you switch off the lights, you can't see these things anymore because just changing the reflectance. So our idea is to use a combination of photochromic and fluorescent material. And both of them are written by the same near UV laser. And then when you when the lights are on, you see the photochromic material's effect. And when lights are off, you see the phosphorescent effect. So it's a day-night visibility, takes only 2 watts of energy, and it's a 16 megapixel display. But here is what we ran into. We wanted to create a color display, but we couldn't find any information about the color response of photochromic and phosphorescent materials, because it has a time profile, right? It's not just instantaneous color profile. And so we bought material from all over the world. Literally, we called up hundreds of places and we bought samples from each of them. And then we set up a very complicated experiment with cameras and samples and lighting. And we took the phosphorescent materials and fluorescent materials and we plotted them with great care. And from that, we figured out what combination of these materials for different wavelengths and different day-night visibility will actually help us build this. So this is still an unsolved problem, so I'm hoping that if some of you are interested, or maybe you know how about color profiles of time-varying materials that can be used to solve this problem. So slowdisplay.org is the website for that, and this was shown as an emerging technology demo at SIGGRAPH 2010. Okay, wish number five. So we talked about, wish number four, we talked about sharing visual experience, being able to create life log summaries, being able to walk through environments with millions of cameras and have complete security of what's going on, new types of photo frames or slide projectors, I would call it digital slide projectors. But there's one more thing we need to solve, which is being able to create an impression, a digital replica of what you have seen. And if you can print materials, we are all familiar with printers that create a reproduction of a photo, but I should be able to digitally print an appearance, not just 3D shapes, but able to print appearance. And there has been some work in this space, but I'm hoping that, I guess it's a wish, that we will see an ability to digitally recreate any appearance that we want, that responds to light and caustics, specularities, and so on. Okay? And then my last wish for computational photography is going beyond the physical parameter and really capturing any sense. If you go to a museum and you hold an object, you can't really capture the photo of that. Or imagine when you're on a beach or you're taking a roller coaster ride, you simply don't have a camera today or a mechanism today that captures the experience of being there. Right? So we need to go beyond the physical parameters and look at creating and create experiences that are emotive. And one can argue that the same way photorealistic paintings photorealistic paintings were made obsolete by invention of a camera, right? And we all moved away from photorealistic paintings. We are really on the cusp of a potentially new visual art form that will make the camera today obsolete. And I think with the saturation of camera, when I travel nowadays, I barely take my camera because, I've seen the same Eiffel Tower, in Flickr images so many times. Do I need to really capture that? And a new visual art form will not try to reproduce the photo. And my colleague here, Jim Forwarda, has this whole philosophy on functional realism and photorealism. What I really want is the functional realism. I want to capture the essence of that information. So I think that's a challenge for us of how to create new visual art forms that will make the camera and the printer, as we know today, obsolete. So here's a challenge. Imagine if you want to take a photo of something mechanical, like inside of a car. I can just take a camera and take a photo, but when car companies want to convey the same information, they hire artists. Kind of odd, right? If you can photograph it, why hire artists? And there are a lot of challenges on the left. There are shadows, there are unnecessary colors, and lots of visual clutter. And artists are, of course, really great at focusing on what's most important. Highlighting important edges, moving parts, and using some really simple basic colors. So there's a whole movement in the late 90s on non-photorealistic rendering. But that was about creating renderings after the photo is taken. What I want is a camera that directly gives me the photo on the right, or at least something close to it. You cannot replace an artist, but something close to it. And the solution for that is this multi-flash camera. Instead of one flash, it has four flashes. And the reason for that is if you just take a photo with one flash, then because of the baseline between the lens and the flash, you get slivers of shadows at every discontinuity. At silhouettes, you get this sliver of shadow, which is annoying. But if you just intentionally place a different flash on the right side, you'll get the slivers of shadows to the left of each depth discontinuity, and so on for the top and bottom. Right? And it turns out by analyzing the shadows, you can extract these depth discontinuities or occluding contours or silhouettes from these four photos. Right? And then you can use those edges that have been captured by the slivers of shadows and superimpose them to create a picture that's arguably more comprehensible. And if you just do a simple software image processing and your favorite edge detector, there's simply not enough information to extract the meaningful edges. And now we might be able to build cameras that gets us closer to conveying the emotions into this photograph. Again, this is just the initial rotoscoping of the scene, and you might go back into your sophisticated editor or manipulator to improve the appearance of this picture, but it takes away the cumbersome task of extracting the shape contours. Well, after thinking about all these different cameras and different display mechanisms, we have to come back and think about the consumer. And the consumer doesn't really care how fancy your lens is and how fancy your flashes are and what's the well depth and what's the pixel pitch. Maybe all the consumer wants is a big black box with a big red button. Okay? And somehow you should just get a beautiful picture. Right? That's all there is. 3 billion people out there using cameras in their pocket. And maybe actually we can help them. Right? There's a beautiful art project from Berlin where the idea was that the camera is actually just a mobile device where the moment you press the red button, you don't really capture photos. You send the event in the cloud. In the cloud, you go to Flickr and you trawl. And let's say you're in Times Square, you go and look for pictures of Times Square that are taken around the same time of the year, around the same time of the day, and looking roughly in the same direction, and bring back this much more beautiful photo than you can ever take with your crappy lens and your crappy sensor. Right? So that's a real danger, It's like Google. There was a time when it was very easy for Alta Vista to create rankings of websites because all of us maintain our favorite links on our home pages. But thanks to Google, we stopped doing that. But then how's Google going to find out what are the most important web pages? It's kind of a cat and mouse. And I think the same thing is going to happen for photography. We're all relying on the fact that there are going to be all these great photos of Eiffel Tower and Times Square. So what's the point in carrying a camera? But somebody has to go and take those pictures. It's a challenge. So Blind camera was described a few years ago, and I like to call the next version the Delta camera. Because what I would like to do is, if I'm at Eiffel Tower and I'm with my wife and my daughter, I go there, but maybe it's a cloudy day, maybe I have not been treated very well with the French lady, I'm not in a good mood, that happens a lot. And you want to take a picture where it's a Delta camera, so everything that's behind the people I care about can actually come from some pre-stored 3D information, because I have my GPS coordinates. And then all that gets replaced are the people and their expressions. And maybe I can go one step forward and say, wow, my daughter's about a year old, and it's very difficult for her to focus and look at me. Maybe actually I have much better pictures of her in my album, so I can just snap them, and if I can relight them, and with much better lighting, I can paste it together. And all I really care about, again, is the essence of that visual experience. I don't really care about capturing the exact photos that are out there. And the clothes she is wearing, maybe they're tagged, so it communicates with my camera, and I can recreate this experience. Right? A little bit scary. All right. Well, wish number 6. And this is really up to you. I want to see over lunch and over beers and cocktails what your wishes are, and I'll try to include that in the website in this presentation before it goes on the website. So we have been dreaming a lot, and I work at Media Lab. I work very closely with imaging companies, and they say, okay, that's all great, looking around corners, that's going to take a few years, all these crazy ideas we have, Ramesh. Tell us what's happening in the next 3 years, okay? So every once in a while, I have to stick my neck out and make some predictions. So I'm going to make them and share with you what I think would happen in the next 3 years. And this is the sequence in which I think it will happen. The very first one is HDR. And I see Dr. McCann here, who has spent a lot of time with him, and I learned a lot from him about HDR. But we want HDR that's not multi-frame, but truly single shot. I want to create a sensor and a mechanism that just gives me 30 bits of dynamic range, right? And very low noise. I think that's going to happen, the very first thing. The next thing that's going to happen is light fields, being able to capture this four-dimensional information, not just 2D intensity, but also angular variation, that will allow you to do digital refocusing, as we saw in the project from Stanford and our group. But that also gives you a notion of depth, and from that you can create stereo, and also you can get rid of geometric aberration as well as chromatic aberrations. So I think it's very powerful to start thinking about light fields. Number 3 is about multispectral. And again, I want to step back and say, even before multispectral, because there's a problem with light efficiency, the first step could be what Ankit Mohan did in creating agile spectrum, being able to adapt or program your camera just either manually or automatically to be able to capture the spectrum that you care about. And again, that's going to change the whole ecosystem of cameras and displays and printers and so on. Number 4, I like to call it frameless capture. Some people think about kind of fusion or removing any distinction between a photo and a video. Much like a human eye, we don't have a notion of a frame. We don't blink our eyelids between every over time to capture the video. And this notion that a pixel has its own exposure time. Not a whole frame, but every pixel has its own exposure time, and its start and end time is not synchronized with all other pixels, but depends on the scene. It's going to be very powerful, and that, I think, is number 4. And number 5 is taking a look at the poor flash. It's amazing how much the cameras have improved, but the flash is still the same. And over time, I think we're going to see amazing innovations. First of all, flashes that are adaptive in what patterns they're projecting. So if certain regions are more important than others, I should be able to change its intensity. I should be able to change its color temperature, of course, in space and in time. I use structured light to get 3D information, or even use time of flight principles to get more 3D information. So those are kind of predictions for what could happen in sequence in consumer world. And independent of how it's done, we can be very sure, and with due credit to Doc Edgerton for this beautiful photos created, you know, several years ago, 50 years ago, using a computation of light rather than cameras, or this photos that are popular on the internet of using the rolling shutter of your cheap mobile phone and capturing the rotating blades of a propeller, and you get this really beautiful effects because of relative time shifts between the rolling shutter and the blade. So what, you know, we're going to see innovations in form. We're going to see abilities to have ultimate post-capture abilities. We're going to see new ways to capture and share our visual experience and go beyond capturing physical parameters and capture the essence of the photos. And we can be sure that computational photography will be there, and the photos of tomorrow will not be recorded, but they will be computed. Thank you.
So, any questions? Well, I think we have time for, you know, one or two questions from the audience. Michael?
First of all, fascinating talk, and your work is equally fascinating. One of the concerns I have is that everything you've done basically collects light in the same single sensor, which is convenient. That means you're sort of multiplexing the information. Yet you do have a finite amount of, you know, like information capacity within the lens sensor system. And now you're distributing it in such a way to make useful changes, whether it's the color adaptation or focus. So have you or your students looked at the ultimate criteria for doing all this interesting work, but still having really high quality images at the end of the day?
That's a very good point. I mean, the visual appearance is often called the planoptic function, and that's five-dimensional, and then you have five dimensions for illumination, so it's actually a 10-dimensional experience, and your sensor is 2D. So you have to do some clever multiplexing that maps a very high-dimensional world onto a very low-dimensional, usually just two-dimensional sensor, and then you have your limits of the space bandwidth implied by, you know, the laws of physics. So you have to be really careful about how you map higher dimensions to lower dimension and how you encode that so that your decoding is compatible and you can actually recover that information. So you're absolutely right that we have to be very careful about devising those mechanisms.
Any other questions? Well, another one in the interest of time. Last one.
Could you comment a little bit on how you're getting trillions of frames out of a sensor?
So the trillion frame per second camera is actually called a streak camera, and it works on the same principle as a CRT in the opposite direction. Basically, photons go in, and then you apply electromagnetic field to it so it can deflect over time. And so you just sample it over different parts of your sensor.
So I'm sure there will be more questions, but please grab the speaker during the coffee break. And another time again, let's acknowledge the speaker.